just a stand-up comedian. He's a Star Trek nerd, explorer, and a budding volcanologist.
Yes, but above all of that, he's a father for the second time. It's Ed Byrne. See you, mate. So, massive congratulations on number two.
Thank you very much.
And
thank
what
you.
Did you decide to call
him? His name is Magnus.
Okay, good.
So he's now, he's 5 weeks old. We have two children under two, so... My wife and I have not said a pleasant word to each other.
It's bound to get better.
No, it's nice to be here. It's nice to be anywhere but my house, right?
It's nice to have you.
Well, it's in bath and bedtime. There we are.
I'm assuming neither of you is going to start crying, in which case...
we'll give you an eye off. Don't you worry about that.
But we are having some pretty bad weather, aren't we? I mean, the summer's awful, but it's nothing compared to you and Andy driving across Siberia... How cold was it? Because that's the latest project, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, one of the most dangerous roads. We went to Siberia. The coldest it got was minus 52. Which is...
Oh, I like that. Yes.
Yeah, that, now that...
That's wow. Although, to be honest with you, when you know it's going to be that cold and it's quite dry cold and you're wrapped up against us, I've actually been in, like, Glasgow, Dublin, places like that, where it's been about a degree and felt colder. Do you know what I mean?
We're not fully prepared.
Not quite as miserable.
Yeah.
But it's, yeah, minus 52.
Is there some story about it? Some farmers wrapping their cows?
They actually, it was so cold, yes, in some places. We went to a place called Oymacon, which is the coldest inhabited place on Earth, and the cows have to wear bras.
What?
To stop their udders from freezing. Because their udders will freeze, and they'll actually, yeah. like, they'll break off and try and milk them.
Yeah. So they clip them around the back
bras.
Of the cow?
Yeah. It looks, actually, because of where a cow's teats are, it actually looks more like it's wearing a thong.
Right.
But it's wearing a bra, which makes yeah. you realise, as Andy even says in the film, it makes you realise that all the cows here are wandering around topless.
I think it would take off in the northeast for the cows, that is. Anyway, well, all of this weather that will happen is great for one thing. Slugs now, and their numbers have supposedly doubled in the damp spring. But the question is, do you like them?
Or do you loathe them? Well, let's find out once and for all. Now, pro slugs is our noted nature lover, George McGavin. He'll explain why we should all hug a slug.
Yeah, and up against him is a man whose first job was actually as a gardener, and he studied horticulture at university. Slide forward, Ed Byrne. There you go, look at that.
But before they slug it out, Lucy goes slug hunting in Chester. Thanks, Lucy. So are the slugs the good guys, as Lucy said? Well, we want to know what you think at home, but not before we present you with both sides of the argument. This is the general feel in the studio.
Yes, have a look.
Slugs
have feelings too. Yep,
peace,
it's all happening
not
here.
Pellets.
We're very excited about this.
Yeah.
It's time to... Slug it out.
Oh, yes. Slug it out. Yeah. George and Ed, you will have 30 seconds each to put your arguments across.
Okay, George, you're up first. Here we go. Good luck. Your 30 seconds starts now.
Slugs are not bad guys. They're actually good guys. They're just snails without a shell and a bad PR agent. In fact, the majority of slugs are actually very useful in your garden. They eat decaying matter, dead animal matter, dog dung, very useful. They really aren't bad at all. And they are the food for countless animals, from hedgehogs, voles, badgers, birds, you name it, they eat it. They're the planet's recyclers. Their slime is amazing. It's used in creams, all bioengineering, and they have... Oh,
What a finish. That's very good.
Slime on your face,
yeah.
George.
Actually, let's use double take something
good.
As well.
Good.
Right. Yeah, there's definitely a line of merchandising there.
Okay, all right, Ed, right. You're up next.
Here we go.
Let's go.
Are you all set? Just slug it out. Your 30 seconds starts now.
Slugs eat salad, which is a... Basically, I don't even like people who do that. They don't eat salad. They eat your salad. If you were in a restaurant and somebody got up from another table and started eating your salad, you'd be raging at them. Why should we tolerate it from something that's basically a stomach with a foot, right? 5% of the slugs in your garden are the slugs you see. The other 95% are underground, nibbling away at your bulbs, and that's not as sexy as it sounds. The French don't even eat them, and they eat frogs and snails. What does it say about an animal? Well, the French won't even eat them.
Luke's face there as well, munching on the lettuce. That's great.
Ah. But whose side are you on? Having listened to both sides of the argument, let us know at our usual email address.
Let us
know!
Oh,
there you go.
straight in there. Now then, if you have children and they move back to save a little bit of money, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to eat you out of house and hope to stay in bed until dinner time.
Amongst the bags of dirty laundry, there might just be a very good business plan. There's a new kind of business that's...
Well, there you go. All the very best for that little venture.
Yeah, good luck, Lex.
Perfect viewing time for a supper club, aren't we? One shot. So put it on in the background, Lex, and everything will be fine. So, anyway, Ed, you're part of this new series, aren't you? World's Most Dangerous Rose. Now, every time I say this, I wonder why on earth you put yourself in that position. Because it's not as if you're with, like, a professional driver, is it?
No. We were driving, and I'm... far from a professional driver.
Indeed.
Quite an unprofessional
driver. Well, let's just put it into context. You've only been driving for 3 years.
3 or 4 years, I think, now, yeah.
So you're not very experienced, are you?
No, and I failed my test the first time. So
why do you set out on one of the world's most dangerous roads?
It's funny, actually, when we wanted to get the travel visa to go to Russia to do it, we told them the show was called World's Most Incredible Roads.
Ah.
We didn't want to pretend that we were showing them in a bad light. But yeah, it was an amazing journey. It's a fascinating part of the world. And we saw a part of Russia that even Russians don't see, you know. I mean, it's a stretch of highway that was built basically by slave labour, essentially, most of it, from Yakutsk to Magadan. It's like 2,000-kilometre road. And it's just fascinating. It's right through the far wilderness of outer far eastern Russia. Somebody asked you to do that and said, we'll pay you to do it. Yeah, you flow.
Of course.
Where do I sign?
But as well as fascinating, it was dangerous, wasn't it?
It was a bit.
Now, here's a clip from Sunday's episode. Have a look at this. Intense.
A lot of the road is only sort of single lane, and then that was like the last day of filming, and we got onto this final stretch of it, which was a proper highway, and we thought it was going to be just plain sailing, and then the weather came in, and it was just a nightmare. And the director was delighted. He was like, "Yes, oh, this looks proper dangerous."
But to put it into perspective, I mean, this is the coldest inhabited place on Earth.
Yeah, we stopped at a place, as I say, called Oymacom. It's -72. It was the coldest, it was ever been recorded there. And, yeah, the coldest place, inhabited place on Earth, permanently inhabited place on Earth. So you've got to think it's also the place that's inhabited by the most bloody-minded people on Earth.
Yes.
I don't care how cold it is, I'm not moving.
Yeah.
But you did this whole trip with a good friend of yours, Andy.
Andy, your Parsons, yeah.
So how's your relationship now? Because that probably would have tested it to its limits.
Yeah, there was a couple of times where we snapped at each other just a little bit. There's a bit actually in it where I finish one of his sentences and he doesn't take very kindly to it. Really minor things will get on each other's nerves. The most annoying thing about the whole show and the biggest hardship, because you're driving 8 to 10, maybe 12 hours a day, couldn't have the stereo on in the car. Because we're filming the entire time. That's part of the joy of a road trip, is blasting out some tunes and we weren't allowed. So that was, to me, I mean, eating reindeer... You know, sleeping in tents at -52, that's all one thing, but not being able to put on a bit of AC/DC.
Well, you can see Ed drive on one of the world's most dangerous roads this Sunday at 9 p.m. on BBC Two.
Yes. Now, if you went to the garden of a Fawlty Towers actor, you'd at least expect to find a little bit of Basil.
Very good. Excellent. Put this.
What a reaction.
Basil Fawlty. Basil. A little bit of Basil. Anyway, oh, goodness me. But there is so much more, so don't worry about it. Two pronounce skills gone. As Christine Walkden found out, and she's got a bit of a thing for a certain colour scheme.
I can't think of a more homely welcome at this time of the year than a curtain of wisteria framing the front door. This particular homely welcome belongs to actors Prunella Scales and Timothy West, and they've been crossing the threshold for more than 40 years.
It was a tall, plain house, and I think there wasn't a creeper over it, and I'm a freak for cladding, you know, and I said I'd love to grow some wisteria, and I don't like mauve, so I had white wisteria, and then I had a yellow and white house. You can't sit out front because it's quite a busy road. So I used to grow the vegetables there. But people used to nick the beans from the bus stop, so that didn't work very well. So now it's just it's just herbs. It's a little herb, not garden.
So you don't mind them nicking bits of herbs?
No, I don't grudge the odd sprig of mint, you know.
We're sitting in the conservatory surrounded by caricatures of Tim and Prunella in just a few of the many acting roles.
It caught on, but the one we had, you know, has been in for... Oh, many years now, and it's doing terribly well. There's a massive bump this year.
This is an established and very personal garden, much of it planted by Prunella herself, including this huge robinia, now so high it towers over the house. What do you think the garden says about your personality?
I don't know. I like quite a lot of extras. I have no idea what I am about. I am employed to play other people, you know, and find out what they are about.
I think it reflects a person with terrific calmness and an undertone of serenity. Is that you?
No, I think I'm probably quite sort of agitated, but I think the garden is very therapeutic in that way. You know?
There's nothing blue about this garden, and I mean nothing blue, or any similar shade like purple or lilac. Even the lilac tree is white. The colour scheme from the front of the house is continued, with the odd splash of rogue pink.
I was warned before I came that you were very much a white and yellow person, so I've brought you a little present.
Oh.
Just a special present.
Thank you.
Prunella alba.
How lovely.
It's a ground cover plant and will produce white spikes of wool.
Thank you so much. I didn't know there was an actual plant and that it was white.
Oh, well, this is the white form. There's a purple form.
Oh, right.
But we didn't choose that. We thought white.
Right. Yes, lovely, lovely. To grow plants and see the results, it's very creative, but it's very medicinal as well.
Absolutely, yeah.
I
like it. Nice garden, Prunella. Anyway, what would your garden reveal about you, Ed?
That I have a gardener.
You have a gardener?
That's it. You look at my garden, you go, there's no way you did all this. Yeah, I have a bloke. That's fair enough. Now, we're going to see you quite a bit on telly, aren't we, next week? Because you're part of Volcano Live, which starts on Monday. And you've been doing a bit of reporting. It's based in Hawaii. Where did it send you?
I got to go to Bristol!
Yay! Who cares about Hawaii?
Yes. Bristol was still exciting, because here's you, recreating a super volcanic eruption with the help of a volcanologist.
Way she jumped, she knew what was going to happen, and she leapt, just even trying to keep her in shot.
So what have you learned then about volcanoes?
Do you know what the most interesting thing, without being too technical, is the fact that the reason why some of them explode is that there's gas dissolved in the magma, and when there's like, say, a landslide, and suddenly the change in pressure caused the gas to come out of solution, and that's why it just explodes. It literally is like taking the top off a fizzy drink. I didn't realise that was part of the reason for for such an explosive. That was probably the thing that struck me the most.
Well, everybody can learn more. Volcano Live starts on Monday, 8 p.m. on BBC Two.
It does. Now, what would you say is scarier, Ed? An angry group of men or an angry group of women?
As a stand-up comedian, I would say an angry group of women, definitely.
Okay.
Well, in the 19th century, a group of angry Welsh farmers found an interesting way to vent their anger over toll roads, which were even more unpopular then than they are today.
And they did it all wearing frocks.
Well, the moon that story was on today.
We did a musical based on the Rebecca riots in our school.
What did you play? A gate?
It's harsh.
No, but I was a crowd member.
A crowd
just
member.
As bad, nearly. Okay, we've had a huge response to slugs from earlier on. Lots of people against them. Marley, age 10, says, I hate slugs. They ate my plant that I brought with my pocket money.
What about this one?
A 10-year-old. Now, are you ashamed of yourself?
Did you know this one? I'm on the good slug side because they eat dog poo.
Yeah.
There we are.
That just makes me hate them more.
That's from Emily Wainwright.
Yes, but somebody does say, please don't use slug pellets because they do damage wildlife.
Yeah.
That's from Pam. Okay.
Thank you very much indeed to all of our guests today. You can see Ed Sheeran on the world's most dangerous roads. It's on a Sunday night on BBC Two.
Yeah, tomorrow Jake Humphrey and Dynamo, the new sensation in street magic. We'll see you then. Bye.
Bye-bye.